Welcome to the After On Podcast. I'm your host, Rob Reid, and this is a series of conversations with thinkers, founders, and scientists. Take a little time and stretch out, because these talks are unhurried and meant to bring you to a top percentile understanding of something important. So, whether you're into startups or ideas, a techie or a lit major, take your time, engage your mind, and you'll be glad you did it. Especially this week, when we'll be talking to quantitative psychologist Don Hoffman. Don has spent the last few decades honing an extraordinary theory about the nature of reality. It will violate every intuition you have about the physical world you inhabit. For instance, Don will say this:
three-dimensional space as you perceive it right now is just your desktop. And physical objects like tables and chairs, the sun and the moon, are just icons that are in the desktop. They're not the objective reality. They don't resemble objective reality. They're just symbols that let us interact with whatever objective reality is while we're completely ignorant about the nature of that objective reality.
And you're going to be like, what? Now, if you're new to the show, welcome. It features in-depth conversations with world-class experts about their domains of knowledge. In each episode, I try to bring you, and myself, a serious grounding in something complex and important that we should all probably understand a little bit better. I hope you enjoy this episode, and if you do, please browse the show's archives at after-on.com or in your favorite podcasting app. You'll find fascinating conversations with some of the top people in robotics, synthetic biology, neuroscience, and astrophysics, among other fields, as well as the founders of some truly agenda-setting startups. Or, another topic, the very nature of reality, which we're discussing with Don Hoffman today. Now, however improbable and mind-bending Don's theories may seem to you, it's worth the time and brain power to suspend your disbelief and listen carefully for the next hour to follow his logic, arguments, evidence, and his highly evocative metaphors. I don't say this because I'm entirely convinced Don is correct about the nature of reality. I am not, and you probably won't be either. But reality's final and accurate description will be at least as jarring and do just as much violence to our intuitions as anything Don is going to say today. So even if he turns out to be dead wrong about everything, processing his viewpoint will help you prepare to comprehend that endpoint description of reality whenever we reach it. And by the way, you should probably also eat right and get plenty of exercise, because getting to our final understanding of reality could take a while. But anyway, once again, whatever that final understanding is, it will be horrifyingly strange, because it'll have to explain some truly bizarre phenomena that have bedeviled humanity's greatest minds for decades, and in some cases for centuries. These include certain quantum paradoxes, the baffling question of how consciousness can arise from inert matter, the exotic sensory experiences of over 100 million humans with a condition called synesthesia. It's impossible to say that normal perception is quote-unquote right, and the synesthetes are wrong. So what's going on? We'll discuss all these things in the coming hour, and Don's account of reality accommodates them all pretty snugly, at the cost of violating most of our intuitions about every other aspect of reality. But we already reject some of our strongest intuitions to accommodate facts that every child accepts. To take an example Don points to at the start of our conversation, what could be more intuitive than the idea that the ground is flat and solid, and that there's a single objectively correct direction, which we can define as up? Yet we all accept that we're walking on a sphere that's floating in a boundless vacuum in which there is no up. This is both utterly counterintuitive and utterly non-controversial. Don's depiction of reality isn't much more intuitively repellent than that. And by the way, check out the competition. A few hours marinating in string theory, the holographic universe model, or eternalism will prove that no one has a monopoly on weirdness. So again, listen to Don's arguments without prejudice, parse them as best you can, and then decide if you accept or reject them. That's my own approach to this sort of material, for what it's worth. I could have spent my time with Don debating his points, which would have been huge fun for both of us. But instead, I onboarded his perspective as much as I could, which has given me a lot more to chew on. And for what it's worth, Don and I should have plenty of chances to debate things in the future because I happen to get to his hometown of Irvine pretty often. In fact, we've already had lunch once since our interview, and as I record this, our interview was just 3 days ago. Before we get started, instead of a few minutes of commercials, you'll now hear me describe a few ways you can help this show continue to exist. I need about 50,000 listeners to make this thing economically sustainable. I went through the detailed math behind that a few episodes ago, and I won't repeat it here. Suffice it to say, I currently have less than half of that. The trick is that I'm a social media lightweight with about 3,000 Twitter followers. I have about twice as many followers on Facebook, but Facebook quite literally charges independent creators like me money to reach our own followers. Now, I tested this proposition by investing a small sum in Facebook promotion back in October, and Facebook reported amazing results. But very reliable third-party data indicates that they exaggerated their performance by a factor of 100. Look, I know what you're thinking. Facebook? Being deceitful, underhanded, and untrustworthy? I know, it's totally weird. But we are where we are. And now that I've lost all faith in online advertising, two things can help me keep this thing going after June. First, backing on Patreon, a website where you can support independent creators with monthly donations. Right around $4,500 a month should cover all my expenses plus New York City minimum wage for myself on the 30 to 40 hours I put into each of these episodes. Again, the detailed calculation was in a prior episode and I won't repeat it here. So far, I'm a bit more than a third of the way there with over 300 backers. So a huge thanks to each of them and may your numbers triple. You can donate whatever feels right to you. If a buck a month is what you can spare, I thank you and appreciate it. At the other end of the spectrum, three people have stunned and delighted me by contributing $100 a month. And of course, most folks fall somewhere in between. Those who contribute $5 or more per month get access to extra content that I post with every new episode. For now, that's ranged anywhere from 10 to almost 40 minutes of audio. And I've got something really thought-provoking with this episode, which I'll describe after my interview with Don. So if keeping the show around is worth cash money to you, even as little as a buck a month, please consider heading over to patreon.com/Rob Reid. That's patreon.com/ROBREID. Now, of course, you can donate $0 per month, and that's absolutely fine because another way to support the show is to spread the word around. The only way I'll get anywhere close to 50,000 listeners is by word of mouth. And if you like this show, the odds are high that a certain subset of the folks you hang out with will too. And I'll bet you know exactly who those people are. So please email them, text them, tap them on the shoulder. Nothing is more powerful than a direct personal recommendation from a trusted source. And needless to say, social media is another great way to spread the word. I've already posted 3 different tweets announcing this episode. You can find them in my Twitter feed. One of them includes an embedded player, which can be played right in Twitter. One links to my podcast's main iTunes page, which is an especially smooth experience on mobile. And one links to the page on my website where this episode lives. So please retweet whichever one you like, ideally with a preliminary comment telling your followers why you like the show. You can find the tweets at twitter.com/Rob_Reid. Again, Reid is R-E-I-D. And please consider following me while you're at it. I've also created a post on Facebook, which is ready to be shared at facebook.com/ReidRobReid. That's R-E-A-D-R-O-B-R-E-I-D. And if today's episode doesn't rock your world, please consider tweeting or otherwise forwarding an earlier episode which did. You'll find a full library of tweets that originated from me promoting all of my episodes and very little else in my Twitter feed. I don't really tweet a whole ton other than informing people about new episodes. For those of you who are wondering how I'm doing against my June goals, the goals I hope to attain by the end of June in order to keep this show going, my total listenership actually shrunk with my last episode, but that's not a shock. It was a highly atypical episode. I made it mainly to announce a price promotion that my publisher was doing on the electronic version of my novel, which is now over. It was recorded live. It featured me as the interviewee, and we talked about this podcast and my most recent science fiction novel. I didn't urge you to spread it around because it wasn't the best episode for new listeners to start with. As a result, downloads dropped by about 15% compared to the prior episode. Now, the good news is the prior episode's audience was up about 20% against the one before that, which was up versus its predecessor, which was up before its predecessor. So the trend lines are good. Patreon activity was also really light last week, probably for the same reasons. So this week, I'd love your help returning this thing to spectacular growth, which we can hopefully continue through my two upcoming May episodes and my June episodes, all of which will be fabulous. Now, if you're not much of a word-of-mouth type person and backing me on Patreon is beyond your means, there remains an extremely fast and free way to support this show, which is to rate it in Apple's Podcasts app or in iTunes on your desktop. This matters a lot because it turns out the number and quality of ratings and reviews that a podcast gets has a huge impact on Apple's algorithms, which is itself hugely significant because Apple sits at the center of the podcasting ecosystem. Not only do vast numbers of people use Apple's apps and phones, but practically every non-Apple podcast player uses Apple's directory. So it's hard to overstate the importance of this. It should only take about 20 seconds to log a rating with Apple. And if helping to keep the lights on here isn't worth that to you, I do understand. But I should warn you, you're about to waste a full hour with me. One quick note, though it's fast, rating a podcast on Apple isn't anywhere near as intuitive as it should be. So for those who are interested, I'll describe the process in a step-by-step manner at the very, very end of this episode. And so with that, let's see what Don Hoffman has to say about the exceedingly strange world that we live in. I'd first of all like to say it's great to be meeting you here in Irvine because I do come to Irvine a lot for a New Yorker. I sit on the board of a digital health company here, and we also have some other family business here as well. So thank you for being located here of all places. It's very convenient.
My pleasure, and thanks for coming to my office.
And you've been a professor here at UC Irvine for quite some time now, right?
Since July of 1983.
July of 83. So not as far back as June of 83, but July of 83 is quite some time ago. And you're a quantitative psychologist. Could you describe briefly what that is?
It's doing psychology and psychology experiments, psychology theories, but being very mathematical about it. So trying to come up with mathematical theories about, for example, in the case of perception, how do we see in 3D? How do we see the motions of objects? How do we recognize objects? But to have a mathematically precise theory. And then also to do experiments where we're doing mathematical analyses of the data.
Now, much of your work contradicts a proposition that I think most scientifically minded people would probably agree with if they heard it. Specifically, that it's overwhelmingly advantageous to perceive reality more or less as it is from a survival and evolutionary standpoint. So if I completely fail to perceive an SUV that's barreling down the road and step in front of it, I'll have a hard time passing my genes along to future generations of pedestrians. And therefore, people might suppose that over thousands of generations, people and animals have evolved to have a fairly accurate perception of reality. Now, however intuitive that proposition may seem, you believe it's entirely wrong. And in arguing this, you quite correctly point out that at many times in scientific history, we've discovered things which seem massively intuitive turn out to be massively wrong.
Oh, yes. So we used to think the Earth is flat because anybody can just look around and see that it looks flat. There are some hills and so forth. But other than that, as far as the eye can see, it looks quite flat. And so until about the time of Pythagoras, a few hundred years BCE, everybody pretty much that thought about it thought the Earth was flat. And it took a real bright group of Greeks to figure this thing out and figure out, no, it's not flat, it's more like a sphere. And then for many centuries after that, almost 20 centuries, the very bright people believed the Earth wasn't flat, it was like a sphere, but they believed that the Earth is the center of the universe and doesn't move. And again, because it looks that way. And we see the sun and the moon and stars seeming to go around in arcs around us while we stay at the center. And so we mistook our perceptions for an insight into reality, and it even was church doctrine that the Earth is the center of the universe, and it fit in nicely with the whole worldview that they had.
And Galileo famously got into a fair amount of trouble by arguing otherwise, and other scientists as well. And it is really true. Few things seem more intuitive than the flatness of the Earth to a person standing at any point on Earth. When you argue that our intuitions could again be wrong, and our perceptions might just diverge wildly from objective reality, yet still be advantageous, you often cite a very powerful metaphor of a computer desktop.
That's right. The idea about the computer desktop is that our desktop interface hides a lot of complexity inside the computer. If you're writing an email and the icon for it is blue and rectangular in the middle of the screen, does that mean that the file itself in the computer is actually blue and rectangular in the middle of the computer? Well, of course not. Anybody who thought that just misunderstands the whole point of the desktop interface. It's not there to show you the truth of the computer. It's there to hide all the transistors and software and voltages and magnetic fields. If you had to toggle voltages to craft an email, no one would hear from you. So the interface is there not to show you the truth, but to hide the truth. But even though it hides the truth, it lets you control the truth. It lets you control reality by giving you just the reins that you need to control it without showing you what the reality is that you're controlling.
Now, when we move from the computer desktop to reality as we perceive it, we find that our senses sometimes make similarly radical simplifications of the world around us, thereby making it comprehensible. An example you use that I find quite powerful is the experience of heat.
So when you put your hand into a bathtub of water, for example, and feel the temperature of it, you just get a simple feeling from very, very cold to lukewarm to very, very hot. But what's going on, the physicists will tell us, is far more complicated, that there are trillions upon trillions of molecules that are bouncing around in all sorts of complicated ways. And all we're doing when we feel something being hot or cold is a statistical summary of something that's far more complicated. We're getting effectively one or two numbers, but there are trillions of things going on. And so we have a huge data compression.
It's a radical simplification, again, without which we simply couldn't operate in a world of heat versus cold. So that's one sensory simplification of reality that we've all experienced. And you argue it goes far beyond sensory mapping to the entire experience of space and time.
That's what evolution has done for us. Space-time, three-dimensional space as you perceive it right now, is just your desktop. And physical objects like tables and chairs, the sun and the moon, are just icons that are in the desktop. They're not the objective reality. They don't resemble objective reality. They're just symbols that let us interact with whatever objective reality is while we're completely ignorant about the nature of that objective reality.
So the chair that I'm sitting on in this view of reality, it has a certain look and feel. It's got a pretty good UI for me. I know where to put myself. I know how to settle myself into it in order to not collapse onto the ground. And what you would argue is this is a radical simplification of something that might be unimaginably complex or might just be unimaginably different, but it is an icon that is as useful to me as the trash folder on my computer. Now, I guess you're going to tell me that there is not actually a trash can sitting inside my computer.
That's exactly right.
So that's also a metaphor. Got it.
That's right. It's just a metaphor. So the trash can icon doesn't mean there's a real trash can inside your computer, but it is a useful icon to tell you that if you drag your email icon to the trash can icon, you'll delete that icon. That's also a warning. Or another example, if you have a paintbrush icon, but there's no paintbrush inside the computer, there is a complex program that you're utterly ignorant of, and it's doing all sorts of things to pixels that you don't want to know. And yet, by having just that simple paintbrush icon, you can do your drawing or your illustration.
And it would, needless to say, be beyond impossible for any mere mortal to do the manipulations necessary within the memory of the computer to have the impact of that paint stroke if we didn't have that iconic layer. Now, when you start applying that to physical objects that we know and love, like chairs and spoons and the sun, it starts sounding like you're taking the metaphor a little far. It sounds a little bit radical, although it's definitely uncontroversial to say that we don't perceive all of reality. For instance, I believe it's far less than 0.001% of the electromagnetic spectrum that we perceive. And other creatures that we share this planet with actually perceive other parts of the electromagnetic spectrums. Sometimes this is called the Umwelt. Would you care to talk about that a little bit?
In my language, I would say the Umwelt idea is that every creature has been shaped by natural selection to have its own user interface, depending on which niche it's going to occupy. So humans, we create a space-time desktop with certain kinds of physical objects. And as you mentioned, we have a certain range of light that we can see, electromagnetic spectrum. But birds have a broader spectrum than us. They can see in ultraviolet where we can't. Pit vipers can perceive some infrared that we can't. Some fish can perceive electrical fields in the water and we can't. And some birds and perhaps bees can even see the polarization of sunlight. So there's all sorts of...
I didn't know they could see polarization.
Yeah, there are some, I believe, birds or bees that can see polarization as well.
Wow.
And so different creatures have different interfaces for the niches that they're occupying. And much of the competition between different species is an arms race between interfaces. For example, with mimicry and camouflage, you're trying to find the vulnerabilities in the interfaces of your predators or prey and exploit those vulnerabilities. Our interfaces evolve due to all these different selection pressures.
David Eagleman, I interviewed a few episodes ago, gave a fascinating example. I'm sure I'm going to get the species wrong, but it's something like the stoplight lantern fish or something like that. And it's a fish that lives so deep in the ocean that red light cannot penetrate. There's no red light down there, but it emits, it phosphoresces a red light. And it has this very clever chemical trick to actually perceive that very frequency of red light. And so this particular fish, they can signal each other for mating purposes, for socialization. It's almost like they have their own encryption layer down there because their umwelt perceives red light. So it is uncontroversial to say we don't see all of reality. It is uncontroversial to say different critters have different takes on reality. And another thing that is uncontroversial to say is that an enormous amount of reality reconstruction or perhaps construction occurs within the brain. And you make this point in your book about how enormous the visual cortex is, how large it is as a proportion of the brain, and why it has to be that big, all the different hacks that it's carrying out.
The standard view that we have intuitively in the case of visual perception, we're just taking a picture of the world, just like a camera. That idea is too simple. A third of the brain's cortex is involved in vision, literally billions of neurons. I would guess 20 to 30 billion neurons. And trillions of synapses spring into action every time you just open your eyes and look around the room. And that's far more computational power than you would need just to take a picture. And the standard view in my field is that all that computational power is there because they think of the brain as a reality engine. We are in real time creating all the three-dimensional shapes that we see, the colors, the motions, the objects.
Because there are profound physiological limitations to vision. For instance, it's only 1 or 2 degrees out of a field of view, which is something like 250 by 150 degrees. It's only the middle 2 degrees that we truly see in high definition, correct?
Exactly. The foveal vision is all we have high resolution, which is quite counterintuitive. We feel like we see high resolution everywhere in the visual world, but we don't.
We do not. The traditional neuroscientists would say that the visual cortex is so large, partly because it's filling in high def where there's only a tiny speck of it. Tell us what saccades and fixations are, because that's quite an amazing thing that the brain has to compensate for as well.
That's right. So your eyes jump around 2 to 3 times a second, maybe up to 4 times a second. You're evaluating the whole visual field to see where something of interest might be happening. So things that are flickering, moving, high contrast, we're always looking at those things.
And not just that, but in normal everyday interactions, our eyes are constantly darting. And even just having a conversation with somebody, your eye is darting from the left side to the right side of their face, etc. We'd think it'd be almost like the Blair Witch Project, that old movie where the camera's shaking everywhere. But the brain is correcting for that. And then, of course, also the back of the retina is two-dimensional. And as you'd said earlier, we're constructing this 3D view. The traditional neuroscientist would say, because we've got this tiny, narrow bit of HD, we're constantly darting around, we've kind of got this 2D image, and we're taking all those inputs and pulling it into this big, full, vibrant, wide-angle HD image. That's what this third of the brain is doing. Who was it that said, we don't see with our eyes, we see with our brains?
I don't know who said that, but it is common in the neurosciences to say effectively that it's the brain that's doing all the hard work.
While the traditional neuroscientific view is the brain is reconstructing reality, I believe you would argue with all that horsepower, there's no reason it can't be constructing reality essentially from whole cloth.
Everybody in my field, all of my colleagues, believe that we're constructing what we see, but that in the normal case, what we construct is a fairly accurate and faithful reconstruction of the true shapes and colors and motions of real objects. And I'm saying, in some sense, something less radical. I'm just saying we construct. To say we construct and that the constructions are reconstructions is a much stronger claim.
Yeah, the traditional view is that that third of the brain, which is visual, is a reality engine. You would suggest that it is a virtual reality engine.
Exactly right. We've had the helmet on all the time.
Yeah. One thing that might support this is this phenomenon called synesthesia. Could you talk a little bit about synesthetes, which are the people who experience the phenomenon of synesthesia?
About 4% of humans are synesthetes, where they have a melding of the senses that most of us don't experience. So to be concrete, one synesthete named Michael Watson, everything that he tasted on his tongue, he felt in 3D space in front of him with his hands. He could actually palpate them with his fingers in front of him. He didn't see them, but he felt these objects. So mint felt like a tall, cold, smooth column of glass. So every time he tasted mint, he could feel with his hands this cold, smooth column of glass in front of him. And every time he tasted Angostura bitters, he felt a basket of ivy. He could feel the texture of the leaves, the shape of the leaves. It was not an abstract idea. It was a concrete perceptual feeling. Here's a case where he's creating a three-dimensional object to represent something that's utterly unlike that object. Angostura bitters in no way resembles a basket of ivy, and mint in no way resembles a tall, cold column of glass. Those objects that he created in his perceptual system were merely icons. They were useful icons to do a job, but they weren't there to resemble anything.
Was his job, just out of curiosity, mixology? Was he a cocktail maker? Because both of those things sound like things that go into fancy drinks.
He wasn't a mixologist, but he was an accomplished cook, because every taste had a unique three-dimensional shape. I only gave two examples. Every taste had a three-dimensional shape. It was a huge repertoire of objects. And so he used that to do some fantastic cooking.
Now, that is an extreme case. So when you talk about something like that and then say that's one out of 25 people, people might say, wait, I've certainly never met somebody like that. But in more mild cases, people will have a very strong association between different numbers and different colors, for instance, right? What are some of the more mild manifestations?
Yeah, that's one of the more common ones, is what they call color grapheme synesthesia. Each printed letter or printed number has a specific color. Maybe one is red and two is green and so forth. For each synesthete, that association of numbers or letters and colors is constant over their whole life. It varies from synesthete to synesthete, but it's constant over life. Another kind that's common is to have a visual experience, say of a color, to something that you hear. And one extreme case of that is a woman named Carol Steen. Everything that she hears, she actually sees not just a color, but a three-dimensional object with a specific shape and a specific color and a specific texture to it.
Mm.
So she has a sculpture she made. She's an artist as well, for the sound Saito. So when she hears Saito, there is a specific three-dimensional shape that she sees. You can look it up. She can see her sculpture and get a feeling for how specific and detailed the objects are that she sees for each sound that she hears. But even that specific static sculpture doesn't quite do justice, because she says, as the word is being pronounced, Saito, the sculpture is changing, it's moving, it's dynamic, and so she can only capture one frame of that. So this is a very, very rich user interface that evolution is trying out, and who knows, maybe her interface will be the one that catches on later on.
As we're talking here, I'm just realizing I might have the mildest case of synesthesia myself. I hadn't really thought of it until now, but for about a dozen and a half U.S. states, I have overwhelmingly powerful color associations.
Wow.
I grew up in Connecticut. To me, Connecticut is yellow. Not the state. It's not like the streets and the houses and the people are yellow, but Connecticut summons yellow. Rhode Island summons green. Massachusetts summons sort of like an earth brown. Florida summons sort of like a bright orangey red. And that's as far as it goes with me. But it's interesting that that exists on a spectrum, and there are these very powerful examples. And this is not maladaptive. These people obviously have not been selected out by evolution, and it actually brings, in some cases that you've just cited, tremendous advantages in certain areas.
Absolutely. For Michael Watson, it helped him in his cooking, and he had an advantage over the rest of us in his cooking. Carol Steen, as an artist, has a real advantage. Anything that she hears creates such a volume of beautiful visual images that she has this wealth of work.
It's almost like they both have unfair advantages in these areas of expression that they've chosen. And it's interesting to contemplate. If we go back on the savannah, it would be very advantageous to not get devoured by a lion.
I would agree.
Now, imagine we end up in an evolutionary environment in which, you know, the survival of the fittest means that you open an awesome restaurant. We've ended up in some evolutionary setting in which only great cooks have lots of kids. In such a world, the genes for experiencing these 3D shapes for different tastes and a very, very rich palette of them could be selected for over generation, over generation, over generation, and eventually all humans will have descended from a series of great chefs who all get to have lots and lots and lots of kids, and that would become consensus reality. Of course, mint is a cold glass column.
Absolutely. That is exactly the right logic of evolution by natural selection. That's why we have the interface that we have right now. It was the vagaries of our evolutionary past and what happened to work in the niche that we happened to be in. But you're absolutely right. In that scenario, there would be selection pressures for us to all have something like Michael Watson's synesthesia.
And instead, we have whatever the really good lion dodgers.
Exactly.
However they perceive the world, the good lion dodgers are the people who've handed down our genes. Now, you've alluded to it multiple times. Let's now get into the theory that with all the hacks and horsepower and our visual cortex and with different evolutionary pressures, different things could be constructed. Let's start by maybe talking about what you call the interface theory of perception.
Our assumption that evolution by natural selection shaped our perceptions to show us the truth, that theory, I claim, is wrong. What evolution has done instead is much more like shaping the interface on your computer, which, as we talked about, is there not to show you the diodes and resistors and voltages and magnetic fields. It's there to hide the truth and to simplify the reality in a way that you can use it to do what you need to do. It shows you a little paintbrush so you can paint. It shows you a little email icon so you can make email. It shows you a trash can. The relationship with the reality is not one of resemblance. It's not one of similarity. There are causal relationships, of course, between your interface and the objective reality. And that's why you can control the reality. But what you're seeing is utterly unlike that reality. So the claim is that when we perceive space and time, that's just our desktop. We're not seeing a pre-existing space and time. The idea that space has existed and was the pre-existing stage before any life and before any consciousness, that's wrong, according to this interface theory. Space is something that you create right now. It's a data structure that you create for data compression and error correction of information about fitness. And then three-dimensional objects are the same thing. They are data structures that you create. I look over here and see a chair. I'm creating a data structure that's telling me certain fitness information. I look away. I no longer see the chair, but as computer scientists say, I'm garbage collecting that data structure. I'm throwing it away to save memory. Now I look back and I see the chair and I create that data structure again because now I need that data structure. The chair that I perceive is there to help me. It's not there to show me the truth. Just like Michael Watson's basket of ivy is there to help him, for example, in cooking and so forth, it's not there to show him the truth. There is no real basket of ivy out there. That's silly. None of us would believe that there's a basket of ivy when you're tasting Angostura bitters. Take the lesson from Michael Watson and apply it to every physical object around you. They're no more resembling the nature of objective reality any more than Michael Watson's ivy resembles Angostura bitters.
So there could be a colossally complex, nine-dimensional, let's go string theory for a moment and imagine the universe exists in nine dimensions. There could be this colossally complex, nine-dimensional predatory force that's out there. And my great-great-great-great-grandfather had some distortion in his brain that caused him to perceive it as giant cat.
Right.
And it's no more a giant cat than these bitters are a bucket of ivy. But boy, did he survive while his cousin, who was gazing in awe at this nine-dimensional specter, got devoured. And that simplification got handed down. And then the interface theory of perception says that the UI is space-time. As we perceive it, as Newton perceived it, as Einstein said, actually, it's more complicated than you think. He was still just perceiving the desktop of the computer, although he was seeing it in a more fancy way than most of us. It really is just the user interface. Objects are icons. And what that means is when you look away from the chair ain't there anymore.
Exactly right. The chair has no position, no momentum, no physical properties when it's not observed because the chair is not a pre-existing object in reality. It's a data structure that I create on the fly and destroy when I don't need it.
And so if we're, again, to take the crossing the street idea, if that SUV is bearing down on you, if it's just an icon, why don't you just stay put? Because an icon never really hurt anybody.
Great question. So I wouldn't step in front of the SUV for the same reason I wouldn't take my blue rectangular icon for an email I'm writing and carelessly drag it to the trash can. Not because I take the icon literally, the email is not blue and rectangular, but I do take it seriously. If I drag that icon carelessly to the trash can, I could lose all the work that I've done in that email. And if it was a letter or a book that I'm writing, then I'd be very, very careful because I could lose a year of work dragging that icon to the trash can. And that's the key point. From an evolutionary point of view, as you pointed out, the symbols that we have been shaped by natural selection to help us stay alive. We better take them seriously. But just because we take them seriously doesn't mean that we take them literally. So I take the icon seriously, but I don't take it literally. We tend to jump from, I must take it seriously, therefore I must take it literally. That's actually a logical flaw. It's a logical error.
Going back to that proposition that I started with, that we see reality as it is because that is very adaptive evolutionarily, that seems logical. When we get to the point of saying, actually, space-time is a UI, and real reality is radically different from that, the question might be, well, why would we do such a thing? Why would we and our ancestors craft something that has no bearing to underlying reality? Your answer actually is evolutionary pressure, counterintuitively, that a species which sees reality in a pristinely accurate way competes with a rival species that throws away most or even all of reality for a more agile metaphor. The latter species will win every time. Is that correct?
That's right. So I'm saying something that's even more radical than just the idea that our perceptions are simplification of reality. Most people would say, I understand that evolution is going to do things on the cheap and try to do things fast. And so we're going to get sketches of the table, not get the full detail of the table. And we'll just get sketches of things that we need to stay alive. I'm saying something more radical. I'm saying that when evolution by natural selection is shaping our perceptions, the selection forces are uniformly against anything at all like the truth. In evolutionary game theory, these functions tell you what payoffs you will get for the various actions you take, given the state of the world, given what creature you are, given your state. The whole game is to get more fitness payoffs than your competition. So if you do anything besides look at the payoffs, you're going to lose. And it turns out the fitness functions themselves are just utterly unlike objective reality.
Now, this is what you call fitness before truth.
That's right.
And you've done a lot of mathematic modeling, which you argue supports this.
That's right. So with two of my graduate students, Justin Mark and Brian Marion, we did genetic algorithms and evolutionary game simulations. We ran hundreds of thousands, even millions of randomly chosen worlds with resources that we would throw into them. And we would put creatures in these worlds. We played God. We let some creatures see all of the truth. We put others that saw nothing of the truth and were just tuned to the fitness functions. And we let them compete. And what we found uniformly was that organisms that saw the truth never outcompeted organisms of equal complexity that were just tuned to the fitness functions. They were in a world where they could wander around and forage for resources. It was a foraging game. But their perceptions had to evolve and their actions had to evolve. And so their initial actions were really stupid and their initial perceptions were completely crazy. But after 500 generations, the creatures that evolved were foraging optimally. And so we could look and see, of those creatures that survived 500 generations and bred, what kind of perceptions did they have? None of them saw the truth. All of them were tuned to the fitness functions. And in fact, I doubt in the complex world that at any stage in the genetic evolution would a true perceiving creature ever arise. There would be no selection pressures for it to appear at any point.
Now, one of the very weird elements of reality that you argue supports this is the famous double slit experiment. And for those listeners who know exactly what the double slit experiment is, lucky you. For those who do not, it's a notoriously difficult thing to explain without visuals. And in fact, it's a notoriously difficult thing to explain with visuals. Since I'm the non-scientist in the room, I'm going to attempt to explain it. Because if I can understand it, most people probably can. And this is an experiment that should be pointed out, has been carried out probably thousands of times now, correct?
Yes.
Highly, highly consistent from experiment to experiment. This is an utterly non-controversial statement
right.
about the way reality works. Specifically, light, electrons, and certain other things sometimes behave like a bunch of particles and at other times behave like waves. They have this strange dual nature, which becomes evident at a very, very tiny level, at the quantum level. So first, to visualize the particle nature of light, imagine you have one of those machines that shoots tennis balls, and they're all soaked in blue paint, and you're standing in front of a wall that has two large vertical slits in it. And behind the wall is a canvas, like an artist's canvas, a couple feet behind the wall. And you start firing these tennis balls. What'll happen is that most of the tennis balls are just going to bounce off the wall, but a certain set of them are going to go sailing on some angle through the left slit, and some of them are going to go sailing on another set of angles through the right slit. After a certain amount of time, if you go around and you see your artwork that's resulted, you're going to see a cluster of blue spots where the tennis balls came through the left slit, and another cluster where they came through the right slit. And that is basically what would happen if light were behaving like a particle.
Right.
So in a sense, these tennis balls are behaving very particle-like, very much like lone photons should behave, photons being the tiniest indivisible units of light. Particles flying through two slits should behave like our tennis balls and create two clusters of dots. That with photons, we use photographic film or a digital sensor to record where they land rather than a canvas. Now, to visualize what happens when light acts like a wave, imagine we have a huge, deep pan of blue paint. It's so deep we can lower the wall with the two openings halfway into it. So now it's like we have two arched doorways on this little sea of paint instead of two slits. And the pan is filled right to the rim. One more drop of paint and it's overflowing. And the far edge of the pan is touching a fresh canvas. So we're going to make some more art. Now, on our side of the pan, across from the canvas, we start dropping rocks into the paint at regular intervals to make a series of waves. Those waves radiate out in the form of expanding semicircles toward the wall with the two arched doorways. Now, when a wave hits, most of it's stopped by the wall, but the parts that go through the doorways become two mini waves, which themselves start radiating out as semicircles. Now, when these two new sets of waves meet, they're going to interfere with each other. Sometimes the crest of a left side wave will meet with the crest of a right side wave, and they'll join up and become a higher crest. Other times, a crest will meet a trough, and they'll cancel out. At that point of the wavefront, there will be no wave. Eventually, these much more complicated waves come to the far end of the pan, and they splash over the side. Where two crests have teamed up, they'll make a higher and deeper mark. Where a crest and a trough meet, there's nothing, so they'll make no mark at all. And the result will be a banded pattern of paint on our canvas, light, dark, light, dark, light, dark, or a banded pattern of light on our sensor if we're using light instead of paint. And here, our light is acting like waves. Okay, now imagine you're a grad student replicating the famous double slit experiment for the umpteen thousandth time. If you just shine a steady light at the two slits, on the far side, you're going to get the classic banding pattern of waves. So how do you get the two shotgun patterns? Well, a logical answer might be to start firing the light just one photon at a time, because then you're only sending over solitary packets. And you'd think a solitary packet has to either go through the left slit or the right one. Once you've fired enough single photons to create a discernible pattern on the sensor, it's going to be two shotgun clusters, right? Well, wrong. You actually get the banded pattern again. It's like the photons, despite going through one slit or the other, one at a time, somehow choreographed themselves. They coordinated their landings on the sensor so that instead of producing the dual shotgun pattern of random particles, they made this very specific pattern, which should only be made by waves of light. It's like you expected a mob of random people to act like individuals, but you've got a North Korean stadium putting on a synchronized show. It's like a conspiracy of photons that are ganging up to play a trick on you. So to figure out what's going on, you put a detector on each slit, which will detect whether or not a photon goes through it. And this way, you'll know which side each photon goes through before making its contribution to the banding pattern. But now, the photons suddenly start acting like particles, like tennis balls, and they obediently create the two shotgun patterns rather than the banded interference pattern. It's like they know they're being watched, or measured to be more precise, and sure enough, if you turn off the detectors, the photons go back to making the banded patterns of interfering waves. Now, we could go on for days about what might be causing this, but the cliff notes are that many decades after discovering this, thousands of the brightest minds on Earth have no idea. Did I get it more or less right?
Yeah, that's a very good example. It's one of the most clear I've heard.
So what that says, and I'm going to quote something that you've written, We don't passively observe a pre-existing objective reality, but actively participate in constructing reality by our actions. And that's, I guess, how you would tie the double-slit experiment to this whole argument that we create reality by looking at it. But you're talking about chairs, not photons.
That's right. So the double-slit experiment is one of the weirdest things in quantum mechanics. And it indicates that when you don't observe, you cannot say which slit the particle went through. You can't say what its position is. And for most particles, you can't say what its momentum is, what its spin, all these properties. Unless you observe, you cannot say what those properties are.
And those properties don't actually take a property until they are observed.
And that's the wild thing. And Einstein was worried about this, right? This is why Einstein didn't like quantum mechanics. He wanted a world in which particles really had positions and momenta, even when they weren't observed. And quantum mechanics doesn't allow you to specify what those positions and momenta are unless you observe. So Einstein said, well, whatever quantum mechanics is, it's incomplete. And maybe it's not false, but it's not complete. There's really a position and really momentum. That's called realism, that even if you don't measure, particle has a real possession or real momentum, real definite values. That's called realism. And there's
another reality exists whether you measure it or not.
Exactly right. The other concept is locality, that these properties like position and momentum have influences that don't propagate faster than the speed of light. And so local realism is the claim.
And that is an intuition that would feel to a reasonably physics savvy person about as strong as the proposition that the Earth is flat. It just seems overwhelmingly logical.
That's right. It seems like, of course, it's going to be true. And it turns out it's false. It's been tested many, many times. There was a theorem by John Bell in 1963 that showed us how we could, in principle, test whether local realism is true. And local realism is false. It's been tested many, many times. All sorts of loopholes have been proposed and closed. And every time we close a loophole, we still get the same effect. Local realism is false.
And then John Wheeler, another great physicist who I think did a lot of collaboration with Niels Bohr and other people in the early 20th century on nuclear work, he came up with a thought experiment which made this weird thing slightly weirder.
That's right. So Wheeler has what's called the delayed choice experiment. It's the double slit experiment, but after you've shot that photon to the double slits and you wait until it seems like the photon should already be past the double slits, and then you decide, am I going to measure which slit it came through, or am I not going to do that, and I'm just going to let an interference pattern occur? So I wait until after the photon should have already been passed to make that decision. And quantum mechanics says it shouldn't affect things. It shouldn't matter when you make that decision. So Wheeler's delayed choice experiment has been done, and quantum mechanics is right. You can make the choice after, quote unquote, the particle should have already gone through or passed the slits, and you still get the same effect.
So if you're firing photons in this experiment from a significant distance, I mean, light travels, what is it, about a foot per nanosecond or something like that?
That's right.
And so in this experiment, you fire your photon a long enough distance that the scientific apparatus has enough nanoseconds to actually act. And it has gone through a slit, and one of the two slits, or it has not, or it's done whatever weird quantum thing it's going to do. But the point is, after it's passed the hurdle of the slits, then and only then is the decision effectively made to determine if a photon has just gone through a specific slit in the very recent past. That decision's made just as the photon's about to hit the sensor. And if we decide retroactively that we're going to pin it down to having gone through one slit or the other, the photon will then hit the sensor in a way that contributes to that shotgun pattern.
Right, right.
That suggests it was acting like a particle all along. Whereas if we don't measure it, it's going to hit the sensor in a way that contributes to a banding pattern. But because it's just about to hit the sensor when the decision's made, it either has to know what's going to be chosen in advance so that it can position itself to land at the correct spot and contribute to the correct pattern, or it has to rewrite its own history since passing through the slit in order to position itself correctly. And this incredibly creepy thing has in fact been done in the lab. And at least in theory, if we were looking at some very, very distant object, like a galaxy that's 10 billion light years away, had that experiment been done with those photons, they will presumably behave in the same manner, which means that on a photon that left its home star 9 billion years ago, we can, in effect, impose 9 billion years of history on that thing by observing or not observing something that it does in its last instant of travel from here to our detector.
That's right. And John Wheeler actually proposed this kind of experiment, a cosmological delayed choice double-slit experiment. So if you have a quasar that's 10 billion light years away, and you have a black hole between us and that quasar, or a big galaxy, according to Einstein's theory of general relativity, it bends space, and you can get, if circumstances are right, a gravitational lens. From Earth, it can look like there are actually two quasars, when in fact there's only one quasar, but it's an optical illusion created by bending of space. So you can now ask, for each photon that comes to me, do I want to decide whether it came on the left side of the gravitational lens billions of years ago, or did it come from the right side, or do I want to just measure the interference pattern? So suppose I make the choice now, and I decide to measure which side it came on, and I find out that it went on the left side. That means I can say for the last 10 billion years, that photon has been on a path that started from the quasar and went around the left side of the gravitational lens. But if instead today I had chosen to not measure that, just measure the interference pattern, then it would not be true that for the last 9 billion years or 10 billion years, that photon had gone around the left side. So the choice I make today determines the 10 billion year history of that photon.
I should point out that gravitational lensing has been overwhelmingly and demonstrably proven. There's lots of images that astrophysicists have captured, and you just Google them, where you see double images of galaxies. There's even some triple and quintuple images that are out there. So now I think you've argued pretty vociferously that we are seeing a user interface that looks like space-time. Space-time is not objective reality. What is objective reality?
The right answer is I don't know. But as a scientist, I'm going to try to propose a theory and try to make it precise and make it testable and see where we go. So the theory that I'm proposing is that consciousness is fundamental. And by that, I mean conscious experiences like experiencing the taste of chocolate, the pain of a headache, the feel of velvet, the smell of a rose, the sound of a trumpet, all these things as conscious experiences, that these are not latecomers in the universe. They are the foundational entities.
Those experiences or consciousness, a being's sense of presence and consciousness.
Those experiences themselves as part of a conscious experience are going to be fundamental, plus the agent that actually experiences them. These conscious agents have experiences like the taste of chocolate. They have then decisions that they can make about how they might want to affect the experiences of other agents. And so it's all about having experiences and deciding what experiences you're going to pass and how you're going to influence other agents. So it's a big social network of conscious agents interacting. And it's essentially an infinite social network. It's infinitely complicated.
And that is root reality in your current thinking.
That's right. So that's the proposal. It's all mathematically precise. So I have a definition of conscious agent. There's a whole mathematical apparatus here that I'm evaluating.
That you're currently working on.
That I'm currently working on with some colleagues. And then the idea is that each agent that's finite, when it's trying to interact with this infinite network of conscious agents, it's going to have to ignore most of that reality. Is just too complicated. And so it will have to have its own interface. So it uses some of its experiences as a user interface to compress this vast social network into a space-time data compression format. And physical objects are just the dumbed-down symbols that it uses to represent some of its interactions with these conscious agents.
Now, part of the reason why you have decided to start with consciousness as the raw material of reality is what's often called the hard problem. Would you care to characterize the hard problem and why that pointed you in this direction of starting with consciousness as opposed to starting with physical elements?
So the hard problem of consciousness is surprising. We know empirically that there are lots of correlations between brain activity and specific conscious experiences. So for example, my experience of color is correlated with activity in a part of the brain's cortex called area V4. And if I have a stroke in area V4 in the left hemisphere of my brain, I will lose all color experiences in the right part of my visual world. Very, very striking. Clean correlation.
Very clear locus.
Very clear locus in the brain. And if you take a magnet and inhibit area V4 in a normal person, say in the left hemisphere, then while the person is watching, color will just drain away from the right visual world. Then you pull the magnet away, and fortunately, the color comes flowing back into the right visual world. And we have dozens, perhaps hundreds of these kinds of correlations.
They're called NCCs, right?
The neural correlates of consciousness, NCCs. And so this is uncontroversial. There are many, many correlations.
This geographic mapping of this thing that we experience happens here in the brain. which I might naively think is pretty good proof that the brain is this physical thing that's generating
that's causing
this
it. That's
stuff, right? But you go somewhere else with this.
That's right. So the neural correlates are sometimes geographic places. Sometimes they're patterns of activities. There are different kinds of neural correlates that we might look at. So we have this data, and it's really clean data, and it suggests there's a very tight correlation between brain activity and conscious experiences. And as you said, everybody has been assuming, okay, that means that the brain is somehow causing these conscious experiences to arise, or maybe brain activity is somehow identical to these conscious experiences. The problem is, we've been trying now to develop a science of consciousness, and we actually now want mathematically precise theories
of how from this physical substrate these conscious experiences arise.
That's right. How is it that sodium and potassium and calcium ions shuttling back and forth through holes in neural membranes, or hundreds of neural membranes, or thousands or millions, whatever it might be, how do you go from that description of the brain in a principled way to I'm now experiencing the taste of chocolate without waving your hands, pulling a rabbit out of the hat? No magic. We want a mathematically precise theory. Why should this brain activity cause the taste of chocolate? And what would I have to do to change the brain activity to make it be the feeling of velvet? This is not philosophy anymore. This is science. We want mathematically precise rules that tie specific kinds of brain activity to specific conscious experiences in a principled way that makes new predictions.
And the hard problem is our failure, despite an enormous amount of trying, to figure out how from inert matter consciousness can arise.
That's right. We have no scientific theories of the kind that I just described. And even worse, we have no idea how to get there. We have no plausible ideas, nothing remotely plausible about how brain activity could cause conscious experiences.
And so your response to that is rather than say, well, you know, there was a time for centuries, thousands of years, we were not getting very far with flight. But at some point, lo and behold, we got there. The common response to the situation you just described is like, well, you know, we're pre-Wright brothers here. We're doing all the sort of block and tackle work. And at some point, we're going to be a Kitty Hawk. You're saying maybe we're going about it wrong. Instead of starting with matter and getting to consciousness, you're saying, what if consciousness is root reality and matter is actually a product of that?
Exactly. We'll try to solve the mind-body problem in the other direction. Instead of starting with the physical world that's not conscious and trying to figure out how we can boot up consciousness from unconscious ingredients, maybe we can start with a mathematical theory of consciousness and then show how we could boot up space-time and physical objects as just an interface that conscious agents use to interact with each other.
Is it accurate to say that you currently believe with high confidence that space-time is a user interface and that what we perceive has very, very little connection, if any, to objective reality? That's something you're highly confident in, whereas the notion of the social network of conscious agents, that's a theory that you're working on right now.
I think the right scientific attitude toward any scientific theory is not one of belief. It's a matter of understanding. So it's up to a scientist to really understand a theory, to understand its implications, to understand its mathematics, and then to follow its predictions, test the predictions, and try to break the theory. Good scientists try to take theories and push them to their limits. And when they break, we are quite happy because we're about to learn something new. So evolution by natural selection entails that none of our perceptions are veridical. And that entails that space and time is just a construct. So now the next step that I've taken, which is to say, well, maybe objective reality is not space-time, maybe it's this vast social network of conscious agents. That's a big step. It's a big leap. And it'll be up to me to try to make it completely mathematically precise and make new predictions. So I propose it not because I'm sure I'm right. I'm trying to be precise and bold so that others can show me where I'm wrong. And that's how science works, is we make bold and mathematically precise proposals, look at the implications, see where they go wrong, and then see how we have to change the mathematics. And that's when we start to make real progress.
One of the things that has popped out of the math and the work that you've done thus far is the notion that lower level consciousnesses can combine into higher level consciousnesses. Two independent consciousnesses could create a greater one. And one thing that might appear to support that is these split brain surgeries that were much more common back, I think, in the 50s and 60s. And you actually met one of the people who did a lot of those surgeries.
Yes, I had the pleasure of getting to know and become friends with Joe Bogan, who was a surgeon who did a number of these surgeries.
Dozens of them, right? Not just one or two, but many dozens.
That's right, dozens. That's right.
Yeah.
The problem was epilepsy. that could not be treated with the drugs that they had at the time. And in some cases, it made the life of the patients just unbearable. If you have a seizure every hour and you can't drive, you can't do anything, you could fall down and knock yourself out, it's nasty. And so in desperation, they tried something. There's a part of the brain that has bad electrical activity. It's called an epileptic focus. Maybe it's over in your left hemisphere somewhere. And once that focus starts sending off, you know, random electrical activity in the brain, it spreads like a storm. And you get this cortical storm that goes from the left hemisphere across something called the corpus callosum. It's a band of fibers that connects the left hemisphere of the brain to the right hemisphere of the brain. And then the right hemisphere of the brain gets swept up in the storm and the whole brain goes down. This surgery was radical and desperate, but the idea was if there's an epileptic focus, say, in the left hemisphere, if we cut the corpus callosum, this band of fibers that connects the right and left hemisphere, maybe only the left hemisphere will go down. It will go down with epilepsy, but the right hemisphere will stay alert, and so the person can stay awake, and they can take care of themselves. They won't fall down. And so it was desperate, but they decided to go for it.
And it worked, right?
It was a clinical success. It was spectacular. The number of epileptic seizures dropped dramatically, and the lives of these people was dramatically changed. And most of the family members said, I can't see anything different about the person. Now that they've had their brain cut in half, they seem pretty normal, except now they don't have as many seizures.
But the odd thing is there is now a left half and right half of the brain that have no communication between
them.
That's
right, exactly.
You used a great description in your writing. You said it's almost as if we've had this terrible outbreak of computer viruses and malware, and we've decided to cut the fiber optic cable between Europe and the United States to stop it. But lo and behold, it was working. And so Joe Bogan was one of two surgeons who carried out a lot of these procedures. And you met him in a very interesting circumstance. What was the name of the society you were part of?
It was called the Helmholtz Club. It was a secret group of about a dozen to 18 scientists that met here at UC Irvine over in the university club.
This sounds like the beginning of a great horror movie, a secret group of brain scientists, but it would probably be in a more menacing town than Irvine. But continue.
The meetings were clandestine, not because we were doing something nefarious, but because Francis Crick was a member of the group. And Francis was so famous that if anybody knew he was on campus, we wouldn't get any work done.
Francis Crick being one of the two people who discovered the double helix DNA molecule.
And he was brilliant, and he had demystified life, right? Before Crick and Watson made their discovery, vitalism was a belief that maybe living things were different from non-living things because they had some elan vital, some mysterious special force that kept them alive. And so Crick was really after doing the same thing for consciousness that he'd done for life. He wanted to demystify it. And the Helmholtz Club, we were meeting to pursue that idea. How exactly does brain activity create conscious experiences? And we went at it for a couple decades.
So this puzzle that we were talking about earlier,
the
this is something you've been hammering on since the 80s and the 90s.
That's right. And from the mid-80s all the way up until 2004 when Francis died.
And then Bogan, who had done all this seminal work with the split brain surgery, he was a regular member, right?
That's right. He came and gave a talk and then became a regular member.
And so tell us about some of the crazy things that started to manifest from these people who had had these seemingly very successful surgeries. Who was it that got them into the lab? Sperry?
Roger Sperry.
Yeah.
And he won the Nobel Prize for the work that we're about to talk about.
So Bogan didn't get it for chopping the brains in half. Sperry got it for coming in and figuring out there's this eerie thing afoot.
That's right, for figuring out what was going on to come up with a psychological explanation for it. And so I can give you a kind of experiment that Sperry would do. I'll update it with the technology. Suppose I put you in front of a computer screen and I put a little X in the middle of the screen and you look at the X. And then while you're looking at the X, I flash up for a tenth of a second a phrase like key ring. I make sure that the word key appears just to the left of the X that you're looking at, and the word ring appears just to the right of the X that you were looking at. So it flashes up there for a tenth of a second, then disappears, and I ask you, what did you see? Now, if you're a normal person without a split brain operation, it's easy. Tenth of a second is plenty of time. You'd get it right 100% of the time. But if you ask a split brain patient, they will say, I saw the word ring.
They will not say key ring because they only saw ring with their right eye, which reports to the left side of the brain.
It's not quite the eyes. The word ring appeared to the right of where they were looking in the right visual field. The right eye and the left eye both see the right visual field. But the right visual field gets mapped by the weird wiring of the brain from the eye to the brain. It only goes to the left hemisphere.
Regardless of which eye it comes into.
Exactly right.
The right visual field goes into the left hemisphere.
Exactly, yep. Right. That is strange, but that's the way it's wired. And then the left visual field goes directly to the right hemisphere.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in normal people, you have a corpus callosum, which then sends the information across, right? The right hemisphere sends its information to the left hemisphere sends it to the right.
One and half so says, I got key, the other half says, I got ring, exactly. And then they say, together we got key ring.
Exactly right. You put it together and you get key ring.
Yeah.
But with the split brain patient, that liaison between the hemispheres is gone. And so the right hemisphere sees the word key, the left hemisphere sees the word ring, and nobody saw key ring.
Mm-hmm.
And only the left hemisphere talks.
Mm.
The right hemisphere can understand language, but it can't talk.
Mm-hmm.
So when you ask the person, what did you see? The left hemisphere is talking, and it only saw the word ring. And so the person says, I saw the word ring. If you ask them, what kind of ring? Was it a key ring, a wedding ring, a doorbell ring? The person will go, I don't know. Just ring is all I saw. Now, if you blindfold them, give them a little box with lots of little stuff in it, a key, a ring, a pencil, a spoon, all sorts of little stuff you can put in a box. You ask them blindfolded, please use your left hand to pick up the object that corresponds to the word you just read. The left hand will go through and it will sort, it pick things up, put them down until it finds a key. Even if it happens to pick up a ring, it'll fill it and put it back down and keep searching until it finds a key.
So now the other side of the brain that is not verbal, it saw its own word. And it can't talk, but it can pick things up and it can feel things. And now you're asking essentially that entity, what did you see? And it's only picked up key. This suggests you have two conscious beings.
That's right. I should mention that the right hemisphere controls the left hand.
Right.
And it feels what the left hand is feeling. And the left hemisphere controls the right hand.
And the tongue and the speaking.
The left hemisphere controls speech.
Yeah.
That's right. So that's why the left hand is telling you what the right hemisphere knows about, and the right hand is telling you what the left hemisphere knows about.
And this is the work that Sperry did. And so it doesn't just suggest, it seems to scream that there are two conscious beings.
That's
one
right.
of which is seeing the left visual field, one is seeing the right visual field, one is controlling the left hand, one is controlling the right hand. Only one of them gets to speak.
That's right. The contents of their conscious experiences can be utterly different. One is having the experience of key, the other is having the experience of ring. And you can actually ask questions to these hemispheres to find out about their personalities. And it turns out they have different personalities.
And they'd have to write their answer, I guess.
The left hemisphere can talk.
Right.
So if you ask a person, you can find out about the personality of the left hemisphere. You can ask the right hemisphere and have the left hand spell out with Scrabble pieces or to write with a pencil.
So hopefully it's a lefty, because then they can write with a pencil. But if they're a right-handed person, they're going to have to spell with Scrabble letters. That's interesting. So Sperry literally interviewed the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere separately and came up with different personality types.
Well, it was later work, I think, besides Sperry. But what people found, the personalities are very, very different. The left hemisphere is more upbeat. The right hemisphere is not quite as happy. One case, when they asked a person what they wanted to be when they graduated from college, the left hemisphere said this guy wanted to be a draftsman, and the right hemisphere spelled out automobile racer. Very, very different personalities. And V.S. Ramachandran, a professor at UC San Diego, found one split brain patient in which the left hemisphere believes in God and the right hemisphere is an atheist.
Because the secret society of brain scientists was not cool enough, we now need to talk about alien hand syndrome.
Right. So in some of the split brain patients, not most, but some, you get someone who's got a naughty left hand. I'll give you a concrete example. The person is getting dressed. The right hand is trying to pick out a conservative dress that's appropriate for work. And the left hand pulls out some slinky red thing that's good for Friday night or Saturday night, but it's not good for work. And the left hand refuses to let go of it and won't help put on the correct dress for work.
This isn't a split brain patient.
This isn't a split brain patient. And so there's a fight. As the one hand is trying to button up the conservative dress, the left hand is unbuttoning it. Another case where, you know, the person's trying to make an omelet and the left hand just throws in a whole egg, shell and all, and throws in a salt shaker trying to ruin the omelet. So apparently the left hemisphere likes omelets and the right hemisphere does not like that omelet.
It's just trying to wreck it so they'll have some cereal or something instead. That's
right.
So this kind of suggests that there are multiple consciousnesses that are unifying in the whole sense of self that we end up with. And is this also related to the term society of mind in any way?
It is. Marvin Minsky had a book about the Society of Mind, and he was a physicalist, so he wasn't taking the point of view that I am, that consciousness is fundamental and we can have conscious agents combined to create new conscious agents. But he was saying that there were these computational processes, physical processes in the brain that could create minds, and that you could have multiple minds that were being created by these computational processes. So his Society of Mind view is very, very different from mine.
But nonetheless, your math has suggested that consciousnesses can combine and become entirely new emergent consciousnesses. Is that something that's come out of the mathematical work that you're doing, or is that more of a philosophical supposition?
That's mathematics, and it was a surprise to me. So I have this abstract notion of a conscious agent, but then I've written down a completely precise formal structure, and I've published it.
Could you tell us what the journal is for those whose math goes far beyond my own?
Right. It's the Frontiers of Psychology Journal, and it's called Objects of Consciousness. And it's by me, Donald Hoffman, and also Chetan Prakash is co-author on it. He's a mathematician that I work with. And we have a absolutely precise definition of a conscious agent. And one of the interesting implications of that definition I discovered as I was playing with it is that when I took two conscious agents and had them interact and looked at the system of two conscious agents, that system actually satisfied the definition of being a single conscious agent. And so this continues ad infinitum. You can keep taking pairs of agents and combining them. And so this suggests a really interesting structure. There are the simplest agents that have just two perceptions, like red and green, and two actions. I call them one-bit agents. They're the simplest agents possible, and they have the most simplest free will decisions to make. You take two of these one-bit agents, have them interact, you get a two-bit agent. Now you take two of the two-bit agents and have them interact, you get a four-bit agent. And you can keep doing this until you actually get agents that have infinite number of bits. So now you have infinite consciousnesses that come out of this mathematics, and we have complete mathematical control, understanding these combinations and the dynamics so we can study it. But here we're dealing with infinite consciousnesses. We're now treading in the realm of theology and religion, but treading in a new way. You might think of God as being an infinite conscious agent, but I can now precisely define what I mean by an infinite conscious agent, and I can prove theorems. And these are no longer hand waves or canons of beliefs. These are theorems and proofs that follow from the mathematics.
And working downward, like if I work downward from myself, going down in the direction of the one-bit and two-bit agents, that might notionally be split the hemisphere. Now you've got two simpler entities and split, 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 you might have consciousness all the way down. Going up, staying in consensus reality, might it be something like the culture of a company or the shared spirit of a team or a nation? Might those be actual consciousnesses?
Absolutely. This theory of conscious agents seems to imply that that's going to happen, that when you get a company and people working closely together or a nation, you're going to get new conscious entities that are arising. Now, we may not experience that because we're just part of the constituents. We're not the new entity that arises. And so we won't be able perhaps to experience that higher entity.
We might not be able to detect it either.
Well, that's going to be a question. I look at my mathematics. Is there any way for us as the lower level agents to understand anything about the agents above us? I'm very interested in that question. I can't wait to see if the mathematics will give us some way of looking above.
And then you start treading toward theology, I guess, if you say all human consciousnesses sum up to a super agent that's way, way up there, that could be when you start getting into the direction of God, et cetera.
That's right. Exactly right.
One last thing. Is there a connection between your emerging view of conscious agents and a field that's called panpsychism?
I mean, there are various versions of panpsychism, so I don't want to mischaracterize, but here's a standard one. Every physical object, say an electron, has not only physical properties like position and momentum and spin, it also has a unit of consciousness. It actually has a conscious experience and also some notion of agency. So it's more of a dualist point of view. There really is a physical world. There really are particles with real physical properties, but they also have these conscious experiences. So it's very, very different from my point of view, because I'm saying that the physical world doesn't exist apart from my perceptions.
And so panpsychism, would it say that this chair has some kind of a mental or conscious life? Is it all particles are conscious, or is it all things that look like solitary, unitary objects to us humans? Like, is a teddy bear got a consciousness? It almost sounds animist. Where do they draw the lines between consciousnesses?
And this is where panpsychists themselves will debate which kinds of objects are legitimate to say these have conscious experiences? Is a mere aggregate of sand enough to have conscious experience? And they will debate that. But in most cases, they'll say that, for example, an electron has consciousness, a proton has consciousness, and a hydrogen atom, which is an electron plus a proton together, that also has consciousness.
An independent consciousness of the subparticles.
Independent of those. And so you've got what they call the combination problem. And this is the big open technical problem for panpsychism. How do you take the conscious agents of the electron and of the proton to create a new subject for the hydrogen atom? And how do you take the individual experiences of the electron and proton and map them into the experiences of the hydrogen atom? So panpsychism is a philosophical idea. So far, it has not been cashed out into a mathematically precise scientific theory.
Now, you've got two books that are coming up. I have read the current draft of one of them, which is coming out, is it early 2019?
2019.
And that is the one that really talks primarily about fitness before truth, the user interface, most of what we've talked about. And the second book, which will be sometime in the indeterminate future, is going to go into the conscious agent stuff that we're talking about now, that which remains a work in process for you. What will be the title of the first book?
Right now, the working title is The Case Against Reality. Then the subtitle is Why Evolution Hid the Truth from Our Eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be published by Norton in the United States and Penguin in the UK.
And probably several months from now, January-ish or something
like
that.
Yeah. That's right.
And so people can look for that. And then is there anywhere else where people can find you and your work online?
If you just Google Donald Hoffman, H-O-F-F-M-A-N, my homepage is one of the first that comes up. And the key place on my homepage is a link called the Vita. And my Vita, I have links to all of my papers, and they're for free. So you can look at all my papers. I've got podcasts and videos, and there's links to them, and most of them are free. I've got a talk with the Dalai Lama and talks with all sorts of interesting people.
Got it. Well, all the way from disabusing me of the notion of a flat earth, this has been quite a wild tour of one lens through which one can look at reality. I thank you very, very kindly.
My pleasure. Thank you very much, Rob.
So, I bet you weren't expecting that, huh? Your logic and intuitions may be rebelling against Don's worldview right about now, but as I said at the start of the episode, wrestling with his arguments is a great exercise, both because the actual truth has to be at least as weird as anything he's come up with, and he might actually be right. Don now has the biggest research budget he's ever had, and he's assembled a really high-octane team to help him tackle this stuff over the next few years. So needless to say, stay tuned. After a recorded conversation, Don and I hung out in the courtyard outside his office for a bit, talking about several related ideas. And I hit him with a concept I've been gnawing on for about 20 years, since I first became aware of certain claims of string theory. To my astonishment and delight, Don didn't consider my aging pet theory to be laughable or something to be dismissed out of hand. The heart of it ties string theory to neuroscience in a way that I assumed had been explored already, at least conceptually. But Don, at least, isn't personally aware of anyone who's looked into this vector, which kind of surprised us both. Because if anyone had worked on this stuff, Don would almost certainly be aware of it. I fleshed it out for him pretty extensively in our conversation, and although Don strikes me as being an extremely nice person, I don't think he was just being nice when he said it was novel and interesting. So, patrons, if you're interested in a take on reality that's approximately as weird as Don's own take on reality, head on over to patreon.com/RobReid, R-O-B-R-E-I-D. Have a listen to the bonus content from this week's episode, and please, tell me what you think about it. Patreon has a simple discussion space that you should be able to access and post on quite easily, and I'll absolutely read and respond to everything that you post. Of course, my scenario is nowhere near as well developed as Don's, and it's certainly nowhere near as mathematical or scientific. But what it shares with his thinking is that it's quite explicable through analogies that I think anybody will find accessible. And I, of course, use those analogies in my Patreon post. It's also hard to dismiss out of hand. And if string theory is correct about the nature of reality, the odds may actually favor some aspects of my scenario being true. And don't worry, you don't need a mastery of string theory to understand it. You just have to be aware of one aspect of it, possibly the single easiest aspect of string theory to understand, and I'll do my best to explain it to you. And I hope non-patrons will at least consider joining us over at Patreon as well and becoming patrons. If you sign up at $5 a month or more, you'll find hours of content that you haven't yet heard, illuminating every episode going clear back to the beginning of February. Plus, of course, you'll hear my crazy pseudo-theory. If Patreon isn't your thing, or even if it is, I hope you'll consider spreading the word about the podcast, as that's my other vector to survival. As mentioned before, there are multiple tweets about this episode to choose from, as well as a Facebook post. And of course, there's always the direct and very tactile approach of body tackling anyone you know who you're sure will love this show and insisting they get with the program and download it. And finally, if you happen to be on an iPhone right now and happen to be using Apple's Podcasts app with a little purple icon, the totally free 20-second approach to supporting the show is to rate it or write a review of it. Writing a review takes a bit more than 20 seconds, I'll admit. But whichever way you go, here is the strangely unintuitive way to do this. First, even if you're already a subscriber to my show, indeed, if you're listening to it right now, you need to search for the show's name. In my version of the software, the search button is in the lower right corner of the screen, so hit the little magnifying glass. Next, select the teeny window that appears at the top of the screen and type in the words After On. The After On icon should then come up in the bottom left corner of your screen. Click that. You should then be looking at a listing of my episodes. Toward the top of the screen, right under the After On icon, you'll see three long rectangular buttons. The middle one should be Reviews. Click that. And finally, toward the bottom of the screen, you'll see the words Write a Review. Then click that. I told you it was complicated. At the next window, you can just rate the podcast, which takes no time at all. Or if you feel like it, write a review, which I understand Apple likes even more than just a rating. Whichever way you go, hit send, and you're done. And we're done. Thank you for listening.